This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Folks, we have a truly incredible Dreamland today about the most extraordinary UFO close encounter in history, witnessed by multiple people, as you will see. And the documentary filmmaker has gone back into the past to see their stories as they were told when it happened, and then met them now, years later, and it's remarkable. However, there's one problem, and that is, as those of you who are frequent listeners know, there are audio glitches that occur on this show, and many of them cannot be identified. This has happened in this particular version of Dreamland, edition of Dreamland, and it's very minor. It's only when I speak, which is typical, and I'm sure you'll be able to listen to it anyway, but I really apologize for this. If there was anything that we could do about it, we would. Today on Dreamland, we have Randall Nickerson with us. Randall is a documentary filmmaker. He has recently completed an extraordinary film called Aerial Phenomenon. That's not Ariel as in airplanes, but Ariel as in school. It's about a remarkable incident that occurred back in 1994 in Zimbabwe in a school that was in an unusual location that we will talk about a little later. An important location, I think, in view of what happened and what we now know about the close encounter phenomenon. 60 children, at least, at the aerial school witnessed a landing of a UFO, and many of them communicated with entities that came out of the UFO. I remember back in 1994, Dr. John Mack, we were good friends at the time, in fact, we were until the day he died, called me up and said, "Whitley, I think I've just heard about the most incredible UFO sighting in history. A BBC reporter has called me," and he went on to describe a remarkable story. And Randall is here to tell us that story and tell us about the experience of making this film all of these years later and going back to the aerial school children, now adults, and finding out from them what it means to them now. And I might add that there is a glitch of some kind. And listeners, I hope you're used to this. I can't do anything about it. As you know, I am not alone in this apartment. This extraneous signal, which, as my listeners know, disappears from the radio the second you step out of the apartment, is going crazy this morning, and we are getting feedback from it, I'm sure. That said, Randall, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's great to be here. It's good to see you. Thanks for having me on.
Well, good. Can you tell us, to tell us what it was that drew you to this particular story? You've made a lot of films, so tell us about that.
It was the kids. You know, it was the children that really drew me, seeing the first interviews that John, the first time I saw John Mack's interviews of these children, I was just very struck by the fact that they were telling the truth, their body language, everything about the way they expressed what they were saying, I felt was completely true. Didn't know exactly what they were talking about at that time. That was back in 95. And, that was really what struck me. And the deeper I went into finding other interviews, finding other witnesses, it just didn't stop. You know, I was motivated because it was just, there kept being more witnesses and more validity to the whole experience. that they had.
And so that you first learned about this, were you in one of the John Mack groups? Or how did you learn about it so early?
Yes, it was a meeting John Mack had in 1995. That was the first time I viewed that tape John had showed a group of people. And I just remember that from back then. But just to be honest, I did have an encounter when I was younger, and also when I was older, and that likely very much influenced my drive to tell this story. I just don't want to talk too much about my own thing when this is about somebody else, you know.
It is, but I won't ask you about your own if you don't want to talk about it, but I think it's a very important piece of the puzzle to understand why you're here now and why you were motivated to do what you did, because the whole contact process is about these linkages and motivations. In other words, you wouldn't be here if you hadn't had a contact experience.
Likely true. I don't think I would have ever believed this phenomenon was true if I didn't see it with my own eyes. That's just the truth. I mean, I grew up in a very mechanical, engineering, electrical background. And if it wasn't in front of, if I couldn't either meter it or have it in my hands, it didn't exist, you know? So to run into something like that, that was just unexplainable completely in the worldview I got brought up in, did have an effect. And it actually affected the way I had to research the story, because I had to be extremely objective, you know, more so since I had seen one of these things myself.
So you had this in your background. We're going to have Randy back on the show to talk about his own experiences at some point soon. But right now we're going to stick with the aerial school phenomenon. Randy, why don't you set the scene for us? John must have talked to you early on. You were involved with him in one of his groups, I believe. So what happened when you first heard about this incident? What did he say?
This was back in 95, and he didn't say very much, actually. I happened to be there to watch it, and I was just struck by it. And I'm like, I felt, well, what a fascinating story. I'd be interested to know more about that. But then I didn't see that footage for 12 years. And it was John's very good friend, Dominique Kalinopoulos, after I'd finished a 16-minute film for the psychological community, which did very well, I showed it to her and her sister, and she asked me, would you be interested in doing this story on the kids in Africa? And I was immediately like, wow, absolutely. Because and that was just the beginning.
It's a remarkably important story with a message that resonates powerfully right now, which we will get into as we move on into the show. Now, let's set the scene. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the aerial school and the area that it's in?
Sure. The aerial school is in Zimbabwe. It's about an hour or so outside of Harare. This is the capital of Zimbabwe. It happened in 1994 in September, September 16th, in the morning. It's a rural, very rural community, farms. It's all farms. And basically how this cool school started back in 1991 was the farmers that were out there had to take their children into Harare to go to school. So they decided they wanted to build their own school, and there was a farmhouse that was empty And that's how they started the school, with one farmhouse, and then it grew and grew and grew. And they included the local Shona village, those children. It became a very big school. It's an enormous school, I have to say. You know, not necessarily all the buildings, but the playing fields. It's like a college campus in a lot of ways. It's pretty large.
And which, so it's still thriving.
Yes, it is.
Yeah,
yes.
That's wonderful.
It's a beautiful school. I mean, I wish I could have gone to a school like that.
Yeah, me too. I got the same impression when I was watching the film, that it was a lovely place and probably a wonderful school.
Yeah.
So this is in September. Now, tell us a little bit about the geography of the immediate area, which I think is quite important. And you, toward the end of the film, you get into that a little bit, and there's some extraordinary images of those rock formations where the ancient chiefs are buried. Can you tell us a little bit more about that area?
Well, I've been to the school three times, and it was only the last time that that somebody brought it up to me, that we were, the aerial school was in the middle of all these ancient Zimbabwean burial grounds. I had no idea. So on three sides of the school, and the school's right in the middle. It's a World Heritage Site, which first two times I went, I did not know that. So that was pretty profound to learn, and also to talk to the chief, to the villagers who knew about what happened at Ariel. There's so many people, honestly, there's a lot of other witnesses outside of Ariel School. I was not able to put in the film because there's so many. But I'm sure those witnesses will come forward in time. But there was plenty of witnesses to that event other than the children.
You know, it's a huge event and a terribly important event because I'm trying to think of any other event where so many people saw so much and had such extensive communication. I don't think there is one. I think when John called me up and said this is the most important UFO case in history, I think he was right. You know, he was a very quick study, as you know how brilliant he was. You knew him. And a lovely human being as well. So we have to thank Bud Hopkins for getting John involved, by the way, because this was Bud who first brought John into this. And Bud is a...
Bud was great.
He's a foundational figure in this. And
really?
Yeah.
He deserves to be in the history books, you know?
Yeah, well, hopefully he will be one of these days, because somebody's got to start to write the real history of mankind, and it's not what's in the history books now. There's more to us than a history of warfare, and that's essentially the history of the species is essentially a narrative of these strange catastrophes that we call wars. But there's another history here. There's a spiritual history of mankind. And this story is very much part of that spiritual history, because it's not just a nuts and bolts story. There's a lot more to it. Now, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a brief break here, and you're going to enjoy some of the commercials that you've probably already seen. And that's okay. You might see the trailer for aerial phenomenon as well. And so do go to aerialphenomenon.com, and you can rent the film on the website. I did that. It's 1995, I think. And I watched it both with Leslie Kane and alone with myself. I've watched it twice, and it's very, very well worth watching. Randy, it's so warm. It's very warm. Anyway, Free Dreamlanders, will be right back.
Hundreds of people today phoned the ZBC saying they sighted an unidentified flying object.
It was a bright radiant light.
I've never seen anything like it in my life.
It was the absence of noise I didn't like.
People from all over Zimbabwe were phoning the BBC to say, we've seen something weird.
There were three of us that saw it. Myself, the co-pilot, and the pilot in the other aircraft.
No wings, no nothing. Shiny oval thing.
Ariel School, 19th, September, 94. Could you tell me what you saw on Friday?
This silver thing in amongst this clump of trees.
We saw this black figure running.
His face was like this, and his eyes were down here.
I just thought it was some kind of alien from a different planet.
When you looked at those children, they were absolutely credible.
And whereabouts was it?
In the trees over there.
There was a big group of kids pointing and making a noise and shouting and screaming.
The panic spread. Am I safe or am I not safe?
And he's a Harvard psychiatrist.
Meet Dr. John Mack, a believer in aliens from outer space.
We came away convinced that an extraordinary event occurred here.
I think they want people to know that we're actually making harm on this world.
How did that get communicated to you?
It came through my head.
Somehow there was a message about pollution from the way he was staring?
Yes.
I was just a hard-ass journalist. I could handle war zones, but I could not handle this UFO thing.
I mean, I never felt this could derail my career.
The dean wanted to know, what is he doing?
Angels, yes. Extraterrestrials, no.
John is lost at this time.
This journey is literally to pick up the pieces and put them back together.
Oh, my gosh. I was right on the log when it actually happened.
We are the ones who drew those funny pictures.
Something that I'll never, ever forget.
I've drawn this again.
But I usually kept it quiet.
People think you're crazy.
My husband doesn't even know about it.
You feel so alone in society.
Why is it that we tend to want to shrink this powerful phenomenon to our notions of reality rather than being able to stretch ourselves to expand what we know and to admit that we don't know.
Would you like to see him again?
Yes.
And if you saw him again, what would you do?
I'll ask him some questions.
What would you like to ask him?
I'll ask him, what is he doing on Earth and what does he want with us?
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I worked with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. We're talking to Randall Nickerson. He is the documentary filmmaker who made Aerial Phenomenon about the Aerial School event in 1994. It is an update of this story, and you went back and you talked to the people, now adults, who were children then. Can you tell me a little bit about, I noticed in some cases that this is has been a very profound, I would say life-changing experience for some of them. Maybe for all of them, I don't know. Can you tell me some of the stories that stand out in terms of the way their lives have changed because of this, that struck you most powerfully?
I think what struck me, well, I was thinking while you were speaking just a little bit, one of the kids when they were interviewed in 1994 told John Mack, like, he said, "What do you think it is?" And he said to John Mack, he said, I think there's other animals out there. You know, and it just, in such a simple way, he was referring to those creatures that they all saw.
Yes.
And it was just an interesting way to put it. You know, I've met 43 of them and spoken with them, and, you know, they all deal with it in a different way, depending on, you know, how they grew up, who their parents were, how accepting their parents were or not. I think it profoundly changed everybody that had seen it. And some people are in process with that still. And others have chosen not to, you know, chose to block it out for the most part, but they agree that it happened. But one of the main things, and I got this from their parent, the kid's parents, was that, you know, I asked the parents, like, what did this do to your children? And what more than one of the answers was, it opened up possibility for them. That they, once they'd seen that, afterwards they felt nothing was impossible, because what they saw wasn't even supposed to exist. And it helped them in their careers, of, in a way, to come out of Zimbabwe and, you know, think in possibility that I can do whatever I want. And they're all very successful children all around the world. Lawyers, you name it. Just all kinds of different models and teachers, and just really contributing to the world. That's what I've seen.
That's remarkable. You know, Dan Aykroyd said upon watching the film, it puts the issue in a touching, emotional place. And that is so true, because you get the emotional sense of it very powerfully. And the way it affected people, it changed their lives. There was one case that is touched on in the story, in the film, of a family, the child of a family who had very strong religious convictions and who had trouble with this. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. She had, her parents were very religious, and they didn't allow it to be talked about in the home. She's not the only one that went through that. It was a Christian school, even though they had many different students of many different religions. And they allowed those people to practice. But it was very Christian in its, you know, in the assemblies and But they were also allowed other religions, other races, like the Shona, and even Middle Eastern people, just different people from the school. Was very cross mixed, race wise, which is fascinating. You know, it wasn't just one.
I should say,
it wasn't just a white school, or you know what I mean, an African American school. It was very widely dispersed. So, what was that question again?
How did the children who had trouble? Let me broaden the question a little bit, rather than concentrating just on the one child. There were children who had trouble with this.
Yes.
And the ones especially whose parents rejected the phenomenon.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit of how those children are, how they are now?
I you know, they think about it. I don't know if there are quite a few I that don't know where to place it, as far as, because they haven't been listened to, and they have in the past been reticent to say anything. So I think that's an important process to go through. Some have gone through that, but the majority really have kept quiet. And you know, fear of ridicule, fear of all that, and
yes,
you know, their friends laugh at you, laugh at them, whatever, or religion, you know, trying
you know,
to
when
put
you
it into religious terms,
right? They can't contextualize it religiously, except that these must be demons if they're real, and unfortunately, the religious people, for the most part, have very specific ideas about what demons and angels look like, and these entities don't look like angels. Now, we had last week on Dreamland, we had a man called Charles Upton on the show who believes that these are demons and that they're the jinn of his faith. He's a Sufi Muslim, and it's a very interesting approach. I don't know that it's real. You know, let me ask you this. You've been steeped in this. You've had experiences. You know an enormous amount about the Ariel School incident, probably at this point as much as anybody in the world, or more. More, I would say.
Yeah.
What do you think they are?
I don't think they're in our context of religion, to be honest. I think my personal opinion is they're not good, evil, or any of that. They're another species from somewhere else that's likely evolved far further than us. I'm pretty sure of that. And they're looking at us much like we look at lower order species to us. So I don't think there's, you know, it kind of bothers me that people would think that this is the devil, or, you know, I don't think that's what we're seeing. It's some other species, some other animal out there that has evolved and is doing science with us, basically. And maybe more than that, we don't understand. There's a lot, you know, that I've heard, seen, and interviewed other people that it's just hard to even wrap your head around, because we just have no cross references for it. You know, some of the things that happen to people. So I just think putting it into any kind of religious context, if we do that, we're going to be missing something, because this is not what that is. This is some other species, you know?
Yeah. And why don't you, it's what we call the grays, clearly. Why don't you describe the bodies of these creatures and the heads as the children describe them, so that the listeners can know? I mean, when I say it's the grays, folks, when you hear this, you'll understand. So go ahead and tell us what the kids reported.
They reported when they first saw them that they were in black, you know, very skin tight black suits, that were type kind of shiny, you know, and frail bodies, about 4 feet, 3.5. Some of the kids say, you know, it was about the size of a sixth grader. I mean, that's interesting feet. Way to describe it.
Yeah.
And a very large head that came to a point, you know, here, and very large eyes. They described as rugby balls. So, and the skin complexion was very whitish, pinkish. That's what I had heard over and over. But it was the same report, or the same. They look the same as the reported grays that have been reported all over the world. And I don't understand that, but it was typical, but not typical in being dressed in black. I found that through the research that was a rather unusual detail that had been seen a handful of times. And which made me say, if they were going to make up a story, they would have gone with the popular story, right? But their details were different. You know, they were unique. They had a good amount of time to observe these things. And somehow time was
manipulated. How long were they there?
15 minutes.
That's a remarkably long time.
That's a long time.
Yeah, I think when I think back, I think that John was right back in 1994 when he said that he thought it was the longest time of an encounter like this has happened to people who were in totally normal state in history. And I think it still is.
Yeah, it's the longest I've found. Yeah.
And we're going to get into there's a reason for the encounter. And we'll a complex group of reasons, actually. And we're going to get into that in a little while. But I want to do the second commercial break now. So, Free Dreamlanders, watch and listen carefully. UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field, and when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system, it energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun. Even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun, it will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age, in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to UnknownCountry.com. Right now, click on the subscribe tab. Get started. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved. Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want 2? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. Okay, we're back. So these children were profoundly affected by this, and so were the adults at the school. And some of them are still very much around. And how was the arc of memory in the adults, in the teachers, basically, and supervisors, who experienced this crowd of children coming running up from the edge of the field, of the soccer field, screaming and yelling that this had happened?
Yeah, they are. I mean, everybody that was there that day remembers it like it was yesterday. Even the teachers and everybody that was there. You know, the teachers initially were not convinced at all. It took the kids going home to their parents to tell them, and then the parents called the school saying what happened to our kids, which is what got the school to take action.
And what sort of action did it take?
They had them draw what they saw. You know, they had them, the kids. It's funny because you'll see some of the drawings, and it's not like they had a lot of crayons. Like, they didn't have the full set of crayon boxes, so they used whatever color they could. You know, they didn't have silver crayons. It wasn't like our schools or
right.
You know. They'd struggled to get supplies. So they had all the children draw what they saw, and those were very moving. And then also they had the children write in their storybooks what they saw, and that was a second confirmation from the very different perspectives that all these children saw it from. Some were on the playing field, some were far away by the tuck shop. Some were gathered at the rock, some were by the steps of the staff room. There were children all over the place, in different places, in different positions. You see a lot of the effect when I talk to the people today, just how much they remember, and it's fresh. Yep.
Yeah, because it was so powerful.
Yep.
Now, let's talk a little bit about what it means and what it meant to these children. There were over 60 of them, and some of the children speak rather uneasily about the feeling that they were being, that inside them, they were hearing something saying, "I want you." And that they wanted to go with them, to go with them. And that is very traumatizing. And you have a lot of knowledge, even personal experience with this thing. Do you think possibly something else happened that they can't articulate or don't remember? Could there have been missing time, for example?
It's possible. I mean, I didn't want to go down that avenue because of the story was just incredible on its own. But given the time that was spoken, the different events that happened with these creatures, like that one that you just brought out, that was very important. nobody's really addressed that. You're the first person I've spoke about that with in an interview. But yeah, they felt like those creatures wanted to take them. Did they? I don't know. I think there's more to this story. I do know that than just what is in the film. But I chose not to go down that avenue because the story was so full.
Yeah.
Already. It was so hard to cut it down to an hour and 38. It was really difficult because this is a very big story.
How long did it take you to make this documentary?
14 and a half years.
14 years?
Yeah.
14 years.
Yeah.
It's a magnificent achievement, folks. It really is. Don't forget that number. He worked on this for 14 years. There's something about us, the people who have this experience. I've been doing this every day of my life since the morning I woke up after my first big experience in 1985. You've been doing it ever since you had your experiences. These kids, it's still alive in their minds all these years later. This is powerful stuff. It's powerful stuff. And yet we live in this strange world where it's sneered at and laughed at. I was in a bookstore recently, and one of the clerks recognized me and said, "Oh, Mr. Strieber, I've read your books." And another of the clerks sneered openly right in my face. And that happens all the time. And I guess it happens to you if people know who you are. So,
Not so much now, but yeah, for a long time, I got that. It was like almost like I was walking around with a T-shirt that just had a big question mark on it.
Right.
Yeah.
And these kids have lived with that all of their lives now.
That's why they haven't really spoke about it. I mean, it's a long time ago. They never forgot it, but they just have never had an opportunity or, you know, anybody to trust to really share the story.
Have any of them been hypnotized?
No, not that I'm aware of.
I wonder what would happen if they were.
I don't know.
No, I don't either. I mean, we don't know. Well, obviously, we haven't done it yet.
I just want, if they ever do that, I would like it to be them to be taken very good care of as far as, you know, their health. Because sometimes, from what I've gathered, it can be pretty traumatizing to be hypnotized and go back to the event, particularly if anything they blocked out in their own psychology to make sure they were okay, you know.
Yeah, folks, all you have to do is go in unknown country and listen to my first hypnosis session with Don Klein. You'll hear some trauma. There's a lot of trauma associated with it. Why is that, do you suppose? Because on the surface, you'd think, well, it's contact with aliens. And yeah, for a child, it would be a pretty surprising thing, but it seems like a fairly benign contact.
Yeah.
But it's not benign. It really is very powerful.
I think that's largely because they are so unique. To have an actual creature from some other evolutionary process with great technology, extreme mental capabilities that I can't even understand, is pretty shocking. And also the fact that these creatures can communicate to you through their minds. And
right.
That all of that is traumatic to any animal. You know, like, we are wild animals, human beings. We don't think of ourselves as that. But to a superior species, we're going to act like wild animals. And
that's very astute.
Be traumatized. But it doesn't mean they're... intentions are that. I don't believe that. there, it's just our gap between who we are as human beings and to what they are is so huge that it's almost impossible for them not to have an effect on us that is, you know, disturbing.
Well,
but
right.
I do not believe that's their intention.
It's, you know, it's a little bit like an elephant trying to dance with an ant. The elephant might like the ant very much, but he still has to be damn careful. And so does the ant. My sense of it is that the kids are, there's a lot of buried trauma. I saw that in the adults. And did you sense any of that when you were with them?
Oh yeah. I mean, yeah. Before some of the interviews I did, there were, you know, some of these witnesses were crying. Yeah, that happened more than a few times, and it was a big deal for them to speak about it.
Yeah, they were crying. That, and this is all these years later now. I mean, 1994, after all, is a while back. I knew that. I sensed that when I saw them in the interviews, because they're not crying in the interviews, but you can feel and hear in their voices the deep timber of something else. It's very interesting to listen to, Rick Randall. It really mm-hmm. is. That's why I watched it twice. The first time I watched it with Leslie Keene at her house in New York a couple of weeks ago, and she'd seen it before, but obviously, I mean, she's given you a big blurb and everything, and you're good friends with Leslie, who is an extraordinary person. And, yeah.
I agree.
So, and I felt that then, but when I was watching it earlier today, it came through loud and clear. I was looking at human trauma, profound human trauma. And yet at the same time, tell us exactly, why don't you, and I'm remiss for not having done this. Tell us exactly, lay out the scene of that day. What happened precisely to, the children are playing, they're playing soccer on a soccer ground. There is a brushy area beyond it, and it's surrounded, as we now know, by sacred sites that have a lot to do with the dead. But tell us what then happened.
Well, the first thing that happened were kids on the playground looking up toward the sky, because they were seeing these silver things flash across the sky and, you know, appear and disappear. And then it was not too long later that they noticed one of these silver things on the ground about 100, 200 yards from the edge of the playground. It was quite a distance away, but they could see it really well. And they watched, they started to gather at the bottom of the field. Not all of them, because they were all in different locations, and there was another playing field that was, you know, 15 feet up that was surrounded by trees, so nobody on that field could have even seen that. And then they all saw these, at least the majority of them, saw these creatures come out of this thing in black. And then at least two, at least one, but there are people that have reported that there was at least two that they saw, but definitely one that approached the playground and made direct eye contact with them. And some say that there was more than one that also approached the playground. So, but the predominant testimony is that there was one particular one that approached them directly, and that's where they had that contact, where they were staring at each other, and the world time sort of just became, you know, distorted, and all the things from the outside went away, and they started getting these pictures in their head about our planet and our environment, which was very interesting. And then they also heard quite a few different sounds coming from this craft. which actually scared them.
Yeah, I noticed that they were frightened by the sounds in particular. One little girl calls it the sound like of a flute.
Mm-hmm.
That's what she heard. And the others talked about buzzing and then a sound that became very loud.
Yeah, that buzzing sound and then the high-pitched sound. People describe it in all kinds of different ways, but I like the flute one. And the people that said it was like a flute were in band class. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They were in music class, so they knew what that sounded like, which is very interesting. And that's when, once that sound started to get louder, that's when everybody started to run like crazy toward the teacher's lounge.
Because it must have been absolutely frightening. And suddenly the teachers are in the teacher's lounge and all the kids come running up. How did the teachers react to that?
They were shocked. You know, initially they, you know, tried to fog them off. That's the way they used it. The headmaster used it. They just say, go back to playing. But it did strike quite a few teachers that they were all scared of something, you know, and then several teachers went outside right after this. And
did any of them see anything? I don't think so.
Yes.
Oh, they did. Tell us a little bit about that.
It's not in the film. We decided not to include it in the film because it's a whole nother story. But yes, one of the teachers did see them and was watching them as they were leaving, I guess, or going toward the craft. And she remembers it still today very well. Yeah, I haven't shared that. There's a lot I haven't shared about this story because we couldn't fit it in. There were so many other witnesses, and I had to decide, okay, what's the story here to tell? Because there's so many people, so many kids that aren't even in the movie, and unfortunately limited to an hour and 38 minutes. But there were, the director's cut's like 2 hours and 12 minutes, somewhere around there. That definitely has a lot more detail.
When are you going to release the director's cut?
Probably in 6 months or so.
I think.
It's already been done. We just want to go through and do it again. But we had to cut. That's the movie I would love to have released. But, most of the major streamers and everybody, they wanted it into, around the 90-minute mark.
Right.
100 minutes max, So that's what we did. It was really hard to do to cut it down.
I can imagine. Now, it's available now on aerialphenomenon.com for 1994.
Because it happened in 94.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It happened in 94, of course. When will it be available on streamers?
We're working on that right now. I had a couple of deals with major streamers, really big people, but they wanted to change the film.
And, in what sense did they want to change it?
They wanted to add popular, more famous figures in the, the UFO field. And this is not their story. The story is told by all first-person witnesses. Yes. There's no third person hearsay, and I didn't want any other talking heads that had nothing really to do with the story. So that was tough because I turned down a lot. But at the end of the day, it's like I've been working on this for a long time, 14 and a half years. And in January this year, I said, all right, that's it. I have to put it out myself the way I want it. And then let's prove its success as a great story the way it is, and the streamers will be there, So that's in the works. Who's actually gonna take it? We'll find out. But I'm excited about it because it's just doing, the reviews we're getting are just incredible.
They are, and deservedly so. Now, free Dreamlanders, we're going to take another break. And subscribers, you're going to watch the trailer during this break. Normally, the subscribers don't see anything except the show itself. But I think this trailer is so very much part of the show. And also, it's going to inspire you to go to aerialphenomenon.com and put up your 1995, settle back with your computer, or as I did, cast it to your TV and watch it, because it is very worth watching right now. And all of us experiencers can give this thing the boost that it needs if we do it now. We'll be right back.
Hundreds of people today phoned the ZBC saying they sighted an unidentifying flying object.
It was a bright, radiant light.
I've never seen anything like it in my life.
It was the absence of noise I didn't like.
People from all over Zimbabwe were phoning the BBC to say, we've seen something weird.
There were three of us that saw it. Myself, the co-pilot, and the pilot in the other aircraft.
No wings, no nothing. Shiny oval thing.
Ariel School, 19th, September, 94.
Could you tell me what you saw on Friday?
This silver thing in amongst this clump of trees.
We saw this black figure running.
His face was like this, and his eyes were down here.
I just thought it was some kind of alien from a different planet.
When you looked at those children, they were absolutely credible.
And whereabouts was it?
In the trees over there.
There was a big group of kids pointing and making a noise and shouting and screaming.
The panic spread. Am I safe or am I not safe?
And he's a Harvard psychiatrist.
Meet Dr. John Mack, a believer in aliens from outer space.
We came away convinced that an extraordinary event occurred here.
I think they want people to know that we're actually making harm on this world.
How did that get communicated to you?
It came through my head.
Somehow there was a message about pollution from the way he was staring?
Yes.
I was just a hard-ass journalist. I could handle war zones, but I could not handle this UFO thing.
I mean, I never felt this could derail my career.
The dean wanted to know, what is he doing?
Angels, yes. Extraterrestrials, no.
John is lost at this time.
This journey is literally to pick up the pieces and put them back together.
Oh, my gosh. I was right on the log when it actually happened.
We are the ones who drew those funny pictures.
Something that I'll never, ever forget.
I've drawn this again.
But I usually kept it quiet.
People think you're crazy.
My husband doesn't even know about it.
You feel so alone as society.
Why is it that we tend to want to shrink this powerful phenomenon to our notions of reality rather than being able to stretch ourselves to expand what we know and to admit that we don't know.
Would you like to see him again?
Yes.
And if you saw him again, what would you do?
I'll ask him some questions.
What would you like to ask him?
I'll ask him, what is he doing on Earth and what does he want with us?
Support UnknownCountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. We're talking to Randall Nickerson about aerial phenomenon. Aerialphenomenon.com is where to find out more about this extraordinary film. He spent 14 years making it, and it is powerful. It is, in a sense, about humble people having a truly extraordinary experience that I suppose the presidents and the kings and the princes all want this experience for themselves, which may be one of the reasons why the media turns up its nose, because it happens to ordinary people. It doesn't happen to the people on the high end of the spectrum of human life. I want to go back to something you said that I think is very important about the fact that we are a wild species. And, you know, I wrote about this extensively in my book, A New World, because it's very true. We are wild, and we don't realize that because we're tame to each other. We're tame to human beings. I mean, I'm tame to human beings. But we actually react to these beings the same way wild animals react to us. And that's the source of the trauma, I think.
You're right. So I grew up in a log cabin out in Massachusetts in the country. I had hundreds of acres growing up. So I would encounter animals all the time. I encountered my first bear face to face with a bear when I was 16. And, I sat with him. He stared at me, pounded his paw on the ground, and I took off running like I've never run before. But that was, it started my wildlife photography career, which I've been doing for a long time. I don't know if I have a website, randallnickersonphotography.com, and it shows you where I've been. I've been to Africa and Alaska, and I've spent an awful lot of time with wildlife. And I see, when I go shooting, and a lot of times I'll be in a hide for, 24 hours, sometimes 48 hours, waiting for a cat or a bear to come out of their den. And I see that. It's like almost like I'm the alien, spying in on their world. And it can be very traumatizing for them. And they have a lot of fears because they don't understand, we have things in our hands a lot. They don't know what those are. Fire is pretty scary to them, except for rhinos. Rhinos will, if you have a fire, they will stamp it out. You have to be really careful with rhinos. That for some reason in their evolution they they're terrified of fires. In the sense that they want to put them out right away. So that may be your campfire if you're out in the woods, out in the bush. So yeah, I agree with
you
that.
Out at the same time, I would think. Yes,
exactly. You gotta get away from the fire when that happens.
Yeah.
But I've had a lot of experience with wildlife on the surface and underwater, scuba diving, and It's pretty, I agree with that, what you're saying. It's, we just don't understand that we are wild, in our own right, to another species that, is further evolved than us. And, it brings out a primal reaction. At least as an adult, as a child, it's a little bit different because you're still trying to figure out what's real in the world and you're a little more open and you're not a full grown human being. So you're not thinking of defense so much because you have your parents protecting you, ideally. But I really do believe that that is our best reference to understand what's happening is nature. And our relationship to nature explains to me what my relationship and these and other people's relationship to these creatures.
One of the children calls them animals, and you've used that word too, that comes obviously out of your own experiences and out of your reading of what the children thought. And my wife used to say, she would say, there's a theater in the skies. Look at all the UFOs. There are these events like what happened to you, Whitley, and happens to so many people. They're trying to tame us to them. That's what contact is about. And until they succeed, we're not going to fully understand who they are, or what this is all about. And this event at this school is so important, and this film is so important because it's a big part of the taming process to see these kids as children and then looking back on it as adults. This is what we have to do to begin to get our minds around the fact that, yeah, when it comes down to it, whatever they are, wherever they're from, they are basically animals also, just like us.
Yeah, I definitely, my personal opinion is that they are, I've used the word domestication, but tame is the same thing. I really believe that because that's what it looks like to me. And that's in other cases I've looked at, you know, there's all kinds of different things that occur, but I think they have a desire to, for us to get over our fear.
Yeah.
In order to, so they can address us, because they're being very careful with us. They're not showing up in great numbers, and they're doing it very carefully, like we would. You know, when we, there's a lot of animals you cannot tame on this planet. We've tried. And like there's a black-footed wildcat that is yet to be tamed in Africa. But taming takes an awfully long time, to tame a wild animal. So it makes sense, actually, how they've been interacting with us slowly, carefully, in small numbers right. All over the planet. And I really do. That's what seems to me one of the biggest aspects of what's going on in this whole phenomenon.
And they're getting closer to us right now, which is one of the reasons I think that your film ended up coming out right now, because it is a huge part of the experience of taming. It reaches the heart and it reaches the unconscious mind very deeply. When you see the children as children, and then when you see them as adults, it is enhancing that process of acclimatizing us to them, to the visitors, because you can see it in the children's eyes and in the adults' eyes and voices. We there's so much in their voices, especially at both age levels, that we are reacting to unconsciously. What do you think now? You've lived with this all these years. What do you think now that they are? Are you frightened of them? Or because I go back to the little girl and the other children who thought that they wanted us in some way. Mm-hmm. Was it to go with them or to be with them, to survive? What's the motive?
Yeah. Mm. Those are all very good questions I don't have an answer to. I don't know if human beings are, it's going to take some time and repeated visitations, if you want to call it that, to not have us go right into primal reaction and fight or flight. I don't know how you do that, because it's when you see something like that, your primal instincts take over. And that's kind of what I've been working through, and others as well.
Me
well.
Too.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Absolutely. Of course.
Yep.
The instinctive level of this is important, but at the same time, the planet seems to be running out of time. Where, you know, there's all these earth changes taking place and the crazy weather taking place, fires all over the place, dreadful storms constantly. They say that global warming is unfolding all around us right now, and we're running out of time, aren't we? Are they going to wait too long?
Well, I think what we're seeing globally with the Navy, and, you know, we had the Senate Intelligence Committee a couple of weeks ago. I think there are people that have held this card for a long time and only would bring it out in the most emergency situation, which is what's happening now.
Yes.
You know, the military has had much more close encounters with these things than I think ever, and more routinely, which maybe these things are telling us something, that they're going to be coming around. Doesn't mean invasion or anything else. I think they see our dilemma. I don't know if they're going to intervene with it. They definitely seem to have warned these kids, and they've warned pretty much every other person I've interviewed that has encountered these people, these things. So I do think we're on the precipice of massive change because of what is happening on the planet.
Right.
And I don't know what the outcome is. I don't know how they're going to intervene. You know, I don't know if they can fix this. I would imagine they could. I wouldn't put it past them, because all the technology I've seen is just crazy.
Yeah, me too. Well, free dreamlanders, I have good news and bad news. The good news is this show is too important, and that what we're going to talk about in the last half hour cannot be reserved. It has to be in the public part of the show. The bad news is you've got to listen to some more commercials before you get there. And subscribers, of course, we will keep on keeping on.
Hundreds of people today phoned the ZBC saying they sighted an unidentifying flying object.
It was a bright radiant light.
I've never seen anything like it in my life.
It was the absence of noise I didn't like.
People from all over Zimbabwe were phoning the BBC to say, we've seen something weird.
There were three of us that saw it. Myself, the co-pilot, and the pilot in the other aircraft.
No wings, no nothing. Shiny oval thing.
Ariel School, 19th, September, 94.
Could you tell me what you saw on Friday?
This silver thing in amongst this clump of trees.
We saw this black figure running.
His face was like this, and his eyes were down here.
I just thought it was some kind of alien from a different planet.
When you looked at those children, they were absolutely credible.
And whereabouts was it?
In the trees over there.
There was a big group of kids pointing and making a noise and shouting and screaming.
The panic spread.
Am I safe or am I not safe?
And he's a Harvard psychiatrist.
Meet Dr. John Mack, a believer in aliens from outer space.
We came away convinced that an extraordinary event occurred here.
I think they want people to know that we're actually making harm on this
world.
How did that get communicated to you?
It came through my head.
Somehow there was a message about pollution from the way he was staring?
Yes.
I was just a hard-ass journalist. I could handle war zones, but I could not handle this UFO thing.
I mean, I never felt this could derail my career.
The dean wanted to know, what is he doing?
Angels, yes. Extraterrestrials, no.
John is lost at this time.
This journey is literally to pick up the pieces and put them back together.
Oh my gosh.
I was right on the logs when it actually happened.
We are the ones who drew those funny pictures.
Something that I'll never ever forget.
I've drawn this again.
But I usually kept her quiet.
People think you're crazy.
My husband doesn't even know about it.
You feel so alone in society.
Why is it that we tend to want to shrink this powerful phenomenon to our notions of reality rather than being able to stretch ourselves to expand what we know and to admit that we don't know?
Would you like to see him again?
Yes.
And if you saw him again, what would you do?
I'll ask him some questions.
What would you like to ask him?
I'll ask him, what is he doing on Earth, and what does he want with us?
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there, in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Randy, you just began to touch on the core message here. And can you tell us a little bit about what the children heard in their minds? Because they did hear, they were, I mean, I've had, you and I mean, in most of us experiences, I click into receptive mode as soon as I feel the presence of the grays, because they don't talk. I've heard two words from them in clear language in my whole life, which were have joy. And which was, Anne thought was a terribly important message. But this, there is a huge complex message here. So tell us a little bit about some of the things the children reported hearing in their minds.
I'm not sure how much was audio, to be honest.
I'm talking about the mental part. I don't think there was any audio.
Yeah, it was more pictures and like a movie in their minds.
Yeah.
Showing us what we were doing to our planet without any answers or how to fix it or anything, just projecting into their minds what we were doing as a species on this planet. I mean, it's wider than I was able, there were more children that this had happened to than I was able to interview, because they didn't want to be interviewed about that. But the message was very single to all of them, was what we were doing to our planet.
Yep. Yeah.
And, you know, just pictures of devastation. You know,
one little girl,
necessarily from war or anything else, but from the way we're changing our atmosphere, which is what we're doing. We're changing our biosphere. We're doing it.
Yeah,
the sun's got a little part of it too, but predominantly, if you look at the industrial age and when we got all started getting super tech, we heated up this ball.
Well, we've reached a level of carbon dioxide content in the atmosphere that's, it hasn't been reached for millions of years. I will add, however, when there have been extinction events caused by excessive carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and there have been quite a few, there's been more than there is now. So we do still have some time. But how much is an open question, because we live in a very big, complex, and fragile society. And as we can see, this what appears to be a minor war in the Ukraine has caused all kinds of problems with grain distribution and things like that. And oil prices are going crazy because of basically because of the war in Ukraine. So it's fragile. And it may be more fragile than we realize. We could have a situation where the planet doesn't completely collapse before civilization does. So there's that. Now, and what, some of the words were so haunting. One of the little girls describes seeing in one of the images all these dead trees. I've seen that. I was driving in Yellowstone a year ago with my family, and going up the mountain, you go through acres and acres of burned out forest, dead trees. It's really amazing. And, you know, this is a consistent message. It's my message. Without going into your experiences, do you have a message like that in your?
Same.
Most of us do. Most of us close encounter witnesses do. And then the ones who are, you know, are in the climate change denial syndrome situation, or I should say syndrome at this point, have a problem because, you know, they have this message, but they're not supposed to believe it.
Mm-hmm.
And yet the source of the message seems like maybe one we should believe.
Yeah, I mean, they're looking at us from the outside.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Exactly. Recently, a Google engineer published an interview about a discussion he had had with a major AI program at Google called Lambda. And he repeated a discussion he'd had with Lambda and claimed that that the program is sentient and not necessarily conscious, because we don't really know what consciousness is, but sentient in the sense that it knows itself and has feelings and experiences. And the program's responses to his questions were really very eerie. Google denied that the program was sentient. And I've talked to some other pretty advanced engineers who think that this was, this is not true, that it isn't sentient. But one of the things that was mentioned by the aliens or the entities in this experience was to be careful going down the road of technology. And, you know, they seem to have very high technology. But at the same time, when you're with them, they have only one piece of technology that seems really high, which is the ships themselves. The rest of it is all them.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then you see these things like hypersonic missiles that are going to disrupt the balance of terror, as it were, because when they're fully deployed, they're going to be able to strike before any radar systems can pick them up and respond. So every country in the world with nuclear weapons who has hypersonic missiles is going to be facing the same issue. They will lose if they are attacked at all. And previously, the first strike would mean that you would be destroyed. Your first strike might destroy the enemy, but it was mutually assured destruction. That paradigm is being broken right now. I think it makes nuclear war inevitable. So
I think the clock is at zero. And remember the nuclear clock? We're not in a good place there. We deployed a lot of things up into space for that reason a long time ago. And I hope that, I would imagine they're still there and more advanced. It's a very big concern what's happening in nuclear. And there does seem to be a direct connection with this phenomena, and they're letting us know that they don't like us playing with those toys, which goes back to that question one of the little girls brought up, you know, one of the kids, about how we're getting too technologized. And I think there's a we've done incredibly well at advancing technologically, but we haven't done so well at being responsible with those technologies.
Not at all.
Yeah. And that's something I don't know how we learned that. I mean, we've been advancing so quickly. We don't even take the time to say, well, what are the negative effects of this? We don't even do that. And that's just necessary. If you're going to create anything, you know, what are the good possibilities that this can help us, like nuclear energy, and what's the negative effects of that? Like, they're on coasts, they're around water that can, you know, we saw it with Fukushima. You know, we have to think more wisely about where we put these things if we use them, because there's plenty of other ways to really.
Well, we have Chernobyl. God knows what could happen there after the Russians messed up all of the containment vessels and everything. A bunch of barbarians. There's another issue that is touched on in the film that now we're coming up sort of on the end of the show, and I want to touch on the area that the event happened in, surrounded on three sides by burial grounds. And, you know, my cabin in upstate New York had an Indian burial ground behind it. And the dead play a huge role in this whole experience. I've written about that in Afterlife Revolution in many of my books. And here we have a situation where these apparent aliens from another world land, and where do they land? Right in the middle of a sacred site, which has to do with our own dead. Do you have any thoughts about that?
I was surprised. I didn't know what to think about that. I still don't know what to think about that, to be honest. But I know what the native people think about that.
Tell us.
They believe that they do visit the sites of their dead. And I mean, the sites around Ariel go back, you know, 1,000 years. And multiple chiefs and sangomas, which are the witch doctors, so to speak, in Africa, they're the shamans. And again, they have known about these things for an awfully long time. It's passed down through their history. I got to interview Credo Mutwa, several other chiefs, and one of the things Credo said to me, I was in his village and sitting with him for quite a bit, and he said to me, he passed away unfortunately like a year ago at 91. But he said, you know, we used to think they were gods for the longest time. And we finally came to understand that they were creatures from another world. Mainly because they started to recognize technology, their use of technology. So it's well known amongst the native or at least it has been in the native cultures. So, I mean, that was an area I didn't expect to go in with this film, but it was there. And it was pretty shocking. And so was their comment about, why are you guys not coming to us? You know, if you're studying this phenomenon, we've known about it for thousands of years. And that there was a little angst behind that when he said it, and others, of like, why have you not consulted with us? Because we have a lot of knowledge to share that may be lost at some point. And that was their concern, was us not, you know, people die. Knowledge dies with people's often.
That's true of original cultures all over the world. It's certainly true of the Native American cultures. I have discussed this with Sioux people and with people from other Native cultures in the United States and in the Americas. And they have a tremendous store of wisdom about this. And it's an important store of wisdom because it is has been so processed by their cultures over the generations. In the close encounter experience, we've got a store of wisdom too, but it's not as processed. When Anne started saving the letters back in the early, late 80s, she realized that they would be the beginning of a store of wisdom, but only the beginning. Now they're all cataloged and everything at Rice University. So there's a point of access and a foundation, not only in those letters, but in all of our experiences. But in the native cultures, you go back thousands of years, maybe at the beginning of man, maybe even to the beginning of the planet. So what is your final thought? And this is going to be a question you're not going to be able to answer, but everyone is going to be hanging on your attempt to do so. What do you think, beyond just being aliens from another planet, what do you think, in view of all that we have learned about them and the site of the aerial school and all of the other sacred sites in the world that they frequent, what do you think they are? Is this about the soul primarily? The survival of the body in order to continue the evolution of the soul, perhaps?
I've thought about that plenty. I don't have the answers, you know. But I definitely have thought about that.
But you know, you're going down the right road even without not quite knowing why. Just like the rest of us, we're feeling our way. Is there going to be anything else in your life about this subject? Are you going to make other documentaries or talk about your own experiences? Or?
Yeah, when I started, right before I started Aerial, I was actually doing a documentary on Bud Hopkins. And I had been shooting for 3 years and tons of hours and all the way up till his death. And he allowed me lot of inside. He let me inside in his house and home and, you know, everywhere. And he's got an incredible story. So that's on the block. And also, I have another story in Africa that I'm going to keep quiet because nobody knows about it, but it's also a very big event.
Oh, wow.
Africa seems to be in South America, it seems to be very, the larger events seem to be happening in the Southern Hemisphere, which is, to me, interesting.
That is interesting, yeah.
But there's a lot of stories nobody knows about.
There's a lot
there's
of
many stories I don't know about.
Oh, I'm sure there are a lot of stories no one knows about, because you said it yourself, a lot of the witnesses don't even want to come forward in this story because the culture is so brutal to witnesses. I mean, sure. God knows, you've experienced it, I've experienced it. Merciless bullying and singling out and harm to your reputation, screwing with your life, none of the big publishers in New York will even publish my books anymore. I publish them myself. Some of the smaller publishers would, but they can't do his job as good as I can do myself. So, and they won't, because there's been a gradual hardening against this. Back in the 80s, I was beloved in the publishing community, and people respected my stories and thoughts, and that of those of Bud too, for example. But he ended up in the same situation I'm in, you know?
Yeah. Hopefully that'll change as more and more people are on the technical professional side are starting to look at this and say, wait a second, we have to address this.
And, I hope so.
It looks like that's happening. I've had several meetings that I'm shocked to have had. And it definitely seems like there are serious people wanting to address this for the first time, really, ever. So I'm personally just going to keep going. I have a director and a producer interested in doing my story, which is funny. Because I knew I was living some kind of strange movie. That's how it feels, right? I'm sure it felt that way to you. To have somebody tell it, I mean, that'll be interesting, you know? Definitely been a heck of a ride. Just got to keep going.
Are you satisfied with the ride life has given you?
It wasn't my plan whatsoever.
Not mine either.
So, you know, it was a hard right turn that I didn't expect, didn't want, didn't even believe in that stuff. And then my life changed. I don't know what it would have been like had it not happened. I really don't. So I can't, it's hard to judge, but I've met some amazing people around the world. I gotta say, I don't know if in my career path, if I would have had those same experiences with some just brilliant men and women. And, I think I'd keep it the same. I think I'd want a little more time off.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
You know what I mean.
No, the visitors don't have vacation time.
And I'd like to sleep better. I'd like to have gotten more sleep in my life for sure. But, oh well, next time.
Next time, yeah. Randy Nickerson, thank you so much for being with us. Aerial Phenomenon is the film. Go to aerialphenomenon.com. Right now, and put up your 1994 and watch it, because the more people who make numbers go up on that site, the better chance he has of getting a really good distribution deal in streaming, which we all need, because this film is important to every single one of us and to this world. Randy, it's a great pleasure to be with you, and I thank you so much for spending time with us on Dreamland.
I appreciate it. Thank you, really.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.